the circumstances surrounding the event, the being out of the hospital, the duration of CPR, the time without a sustained heartbeat, and the deprivation of oxygen. After it was said and done, they gave us the survival rate of about 4%. And then of that 4%, the probability of brain damage within that 4% was pretty high.
On the morning of April 24th, around 2:30 in the morning, I woke up to hearing something strange and found my husband on the side of the bed, and he was on all fours, and he then leaned up on his knees and said, "I can't breathe," and collapsed. So I called 911.
Until April 24th, I kind of assumed I was pretty good health. I tried to do a fair share of exercise, and unbeknownst to us, I mean, I'd been living with some rare genetic heart defect, so it was a complete surprise.
So I called 911 and went and unlocked the front door, came back, and at that point they're telling me to lay him down. Laid him down and started CPR. The firemen arrived, and once they started working on Tom, then Chase and I immediately left the bedroom and went to the next room and started praying. At that point, the ambulance arrives.
He was down at home for, we think, around 10 minutes with Lisa giving him CPR. So that's 10 minutes that his body was without adequate blood flow, except for her pumping his chest.
Lisa called me, it was about 3:30 in the morning, and she said, "Jamie, I need you to pray for me. Tom has been rushed to the emergency room. He's had something's wrong with his heart." I said, "We'll be there in just a minute. We're on our way."
Probably 10 minutes later, we still don't have any news on what's happening with Tom, but Jamie and her husband come in, and this is about 3:00 in the morning, and immediately gather our family together, and again, we start praying. That morning, just throughout the morning, others in our small group continued to trickle in. We all gathered around in the waiting room, and the waiting room was packed. I've never seen anything like it. We had so much support, and we all gathered hands and prayed. The support from the church was overwhelming. And at that point, it was very chaotic. There were lots of nurses, several doctors, and Tom was, his muscles were all tense. He was fighting. They were trying to hold him down. And
breathing really heavy and hard.
They were hoping that he could hear us and that hearing his family would calm him down. After a while of us trying to talk to him, we realized he was not hearing us. So at that point, we just laid hands on him and began to pray, and knew that we needed divine intervention. The first few hours, we really weren't getting a lot of information. They did decide to try a new treatment on Tom. It was the first time that Conway Regional had ever administered this treatment. It was hypothermic therapy. And so they were going to take his body temperature down to aid in the brain swelling and hopefully to lessen the chances of any further brain damage.
I mean, we've never had anybody come in who had a witnessed arrest, had CPR in the field, got shocked out of a rhythm and had a heartbeat and a blood pressure and was stable enough to come into the ICU. So with all of that going on, first we're in uncharted territory. We can read about it, but we haven't done this yet.
Everywhere we looked, there was support. There was no chance for me to get down or to really be concerned. At every point, there was someone encouraging me and would pray for me, or we would go in and pray over Tom. And going into his room, there was such a peace. We would all pray, and you could tell that God was moving. There was no doubt when you walk in there, and that's what gave us our confidence.
I told Lisa, you know, this is going to take weeks, and after the weeks, it's going to take months, and after that, you know, we'll see what happens, but this is going to be a long, long marathon.
After the 24 hours that he was in the hypothermic treatment, and they start to wake him up, and that was a very long night. Early that morning, I guess about 5:00?
Well, we were in the restroom fixing our hair.
As much as you can.
Brushing our teeth. And one of the nurses, as I was walking down the hall, and you were still in the restroom, and I, She said, "Is Lisa with you?" And I said, "She's in the restroom brushing her teeth." And she said, "Oh, well, he's calling for her." She dropped that toothbrush. I said, "I'm good, I'm good."
That was
she
music.
She ran down the hall. And
He went in on Tuesday morning. He was able to get out of CCU Saturday, which was unheard of.
You know, within 24 hours of us taking him off of the sedation and off of the paralyzing medicine, Tom was awake and talking to us. But the timing, how little time it took him to recover, was remarkable.
I tried to go up to the hospital to visit Tom in the regular room. So I show up at the room and he's gone. I was like, okay, what is going on around here? So I texted Tom's sister and she said, "Oh, Tom's been released today." And I was like, "Lisa, you did not tell me."
This was a Tuesday and this was a Monday, the next Monday, and he's coming home.
You know, you wonder, being a part of a large congregation, will the church recognize my need? Will they see it when I'm hurting? And it's a resounding yes, they do. So I just don't know how you do it. I don't know how you go through life not being plugged in.
I know I couldn't have had the strength and just the faith, because I know it's the prayers and just the constant encouragement that kept me there.
Every morning when I wake up, my eyes I open my eyes. It's literally, thank you, God, for another day with my family. And my son and my wife are my heroes in this whole thing. You saved my life and you saved our family. And the courage and the strength that they both showed, it's just unparalleled. And it's only as a result of the support that our church and our small group and our friends gave us. So, I love you.